Yeah, that's essentially the sense of my. I mean, if there are no problems from the point of view of the job that I'm doing here, but this I discussed with the previous. Let's see if the. Yeah, I have this thing for 2018, which is going to be pretty big, so. It was quite incredible. I just sent out the invitation and said yes. Yeah. Well, no, these have to see. This we'll have to see. I would be more prudent, but it's just 8 of them. So, and this would be should be a large conference because I think this. He's a PhD student, postdoc.
Probably not at the level of
a lecturer in the US is a leadership position.
But of course, there's plenty to be done, and that's the center in Mexico.
And we did with Claudio, so there is this school in Italy, this is called the Perugia International School. And it's like, it has a long tradition, like 30 years they organize it. In Perugia for 1 month in the summer. Just graduated, or are about to graduate at the university. They just take classes on, say, complex analysis, algebraic geometry, 4 of them, and the 2 of them are slightly more advanced. And they have exercises after every lecture. It's really a great activity because starts knowing each other when they're very young.
Okay, could then establish a.
So I think this would be a bit Claudio also, because this idea of doing something in Central America is Claudio that came up. And then we got the idea of maybe relating this to a Perugia style event. Days, year after year, so kind of creating a stability, so people know it's going to be there, you know? And there is a generation and generation of people that pass through this thing and can that can suggest good students to go there. So this, I think, could have could help focus in the activity and get a more consistent outcome in the years. That's about it.
Okay, good afternoon. So we can start. So today we have a local faculty as a colloquium speaker. He's a very, very young mathematician. He just joined us less than 1 year ago, Francesco Maggi. And he has already made an impact within the group. He has been doing a lot of activities within the group with the students and so on, and we are very pleased to have him here. I can say some things about Francesco, very little, because he's very, very young and I'm not a mathematician. But I can say that he joined us just less than a year ago. He has been in the University of Texas in Austin. He's still officially a professor in the University of Texas in Austin, where he has been since 2012, if I have it right. But before that, Francesco was an assistant professor for 7 years at the University of Florence. He also obtained his PhD in mathematics in Florence and a postdoc in the Max Planck Institute for Mathematics in Leipzig in Germany. He works mostly in variational problems and partial differential equations, motivated by geometry and physics. So in that sense, it's close to applied mathematics and theoretical physics. And I think that his talk today is isoperimetric theorems, open problems, and new results. It is more or less covering in this subject. So so it's a pleasure to introduce Francesco, and I'm sure you will enjoy his presentation. Thank you.
So thanks, Fernando, for the nice introduction. And so is it working, the microphone? Okay. So the subject of the talk is going to be isoperimetric theorems, and there will be a lot of open problems, actually. I mean, there is more open problems than settled questions, I would say. So the basic theorem is, of course, the Euclidean isoperimetric theorem, which is something everybody knows. So mathematically speaking, it's just minimization of the perimeter of a set, of a region of the space, under a volume constraint, right? So you have some region in the space, and you prescribe its volume to be some fixed constant, and then you try to minimize the perimeter of this region. So the perimeter of the region would just be so if this set lives in Rn, this would just be the n minus one dimensional measure of the boundary of your set E, all right? So it's just going to be the perimeter measure of this thing. And as written over there, we know that the only solution to this problem, the solution is balls. These are the only minimizers in this problem. So this is the reason why a lot of things in nature are round, right? I mean, because of this theorem. And you can write this thing. So let me write down some formula. So this is is called the isoperimetric inequality. So here you have the perimeter of your set. This is going to be larger than the perimeter of a ball with the same volume. And if equality holds, then your set is a ball. So there is, of course, a long mathematical history already just for this theorem. First of all, to prove it in various contexts, and first of all, realizing that you want to write down a proof, then to prove it first in the plane, then in Rn, then people start philosophizing about what does it mean to take the perimeter of a set. So, I mean, there is a long history that I will completely cut down. So the theorem is the theorem, and it's over there. And I will pass to the first question that it's very much characteristic of what I do instead, which is trying to understand the stability of these kind of results. So my question would be somehow to make this isoperimetric theorem into a quantitative statement. So my question would be, what information is encoded in the inequality when it's not an equality? So if you just take the ratio of the right and the left-hand side, the inequality tells you this is a number larger than 1, which is 1 if and only if you are a ball. So in generically, if I take my set E over there is not a ball, I got something left. So this ratio is positive. So the question is, what happens when this ratio is positive and, say, small? So we expect to be close to a ball, but not exactly a ball. And this is, given your background, I mean, of course, there are a lot of problems where I can get something like that, okay? Either because I am minimizing some perimeter, so some surface tension energy with a volume constraint, but there is a potential energy term which acts like a small perturbation. So the surface tension is dominant, and the potential energy term is like of a perturbation. Or you have some kind of statistical perturbation, okay? So fluctuation of various kinds. So somehow I won't actually discuss too much the physical, or I mean, hopefully physical applications of this stuff, but I will just, I'm just pointing out to the idea that this kind of thing is somehow, given that the theorem you're using, actually you can somehow quantify what happens. So, and this is a slide, so I have this quantity that is called delta. Delta stands for deficit, iso for isoperimetric. So I have my set E, I compare it with the perimeter, its perimeter to the perimeter of a ball, and I take minus one. So this quantity is non-negative, it's zero if and only if E is a ball, and I'm assuming it's positive and small. All right, so this could happen because my set has a bunch of small components of small perimeter and volume, so which somehow doesn't interact too much with this inequality. There may even be some holes inside the set, and even more exotic things happen. So you may have some parts of the boundary which are completely rough, so you don't really want to look like a sphere necessarily at a small scale. At a small scale, anything can happen. Anything that carries little perimeter and little volume is okay. And the long tensor tree, that's definitely going to be small perimeter and small volume, and even spikes and stuff like that. So this is the typical set with small isoperimetric deficit. So what can you say about them from the geometric viewpoint? So what estimates you can make? So this is a slide where I have, again, the theorem. So this is the isoperimetric inequality for any set with positive finite volume. This is its equivalent formulation in terms of my isoperimetric deficit. And this is the first theorem that I have obtained in this direction, which is somehow the isoperimetric inequality. But here, okay, maybe these curly brackets should have been 1 meter closer to the perimeter of B of E. It's all attached, okay? So it's multiplying. So my inequality tells you that you don't have just this larger than that, but it's actually it's times 1, which is the old inequality, plus a reminder term, okay? And what the reminder term is measuring is the volume overlapping that you can obtain with a ball, okay? So essentially, you take your set E here in red, and you start looking at the ball with the same volume, and you move its center x. So you move the ball so that you minimize the area of the blue part. So it's called the volume of the symmetric difference. So this E delta x plus b of E just means the volume of E that sticks out of the ball plus the volume of the ball that sticks out of the set E. All right? So this is a kind of just a volume estimate. All right? And if you think about my previous slide, it's just a volume estimate that I can get. I cannot say I'm uniformly close to a ball or I have any better information because I could have pieces and stuff going around. But so this is the best I can hope for. And let me notice that the estimate here, the quantity I am adding is a scale invariant. So it's indeed it's add up to a one, right? So it's the volume of the symmetric difference divided by the volume. So it's scale invariant. It's not small because the set is small, say. It's really a geometric information. And another interesting feature of this inequality, okay, it can be formulated as delta larger than C alpha square, if you call alpha square essentially the volume that sticks out from the optimal ball. And the exponent 2 is sharp, which is a nice geometric information, because if you think about it, what I'm saying is that here I have all the sets with volume 1, say, all right? Here I have all the balls with volume 1. And I know if I plot the perimeter functional, which of course I cannot really do, but so here I plot the perimeter of E. So I know that this is the perimeter of the ball of volume E. This is going to be the minimal perimeter possible. So generally speaking, this function will do something like that. Okay, and my estimate essentially is telling you that here it grows like a parabola. So that's the meaning of this square over there. So somehow the perimeter function, even in this crazy setting where E is anything, so there is no a priori parametrization, there is no convexity or any kind of assumption, is really whatever, okay? And even in this crazy context, life is so good that the perimeter functional at its global minimizer wants to be quadratic. So these are good news. The theorem, so when we proved this theorem, we didn't know anything about the constant, just that there exists and it's positive. Which is kind of a drawback, not just for a matter of curiosity, but you see, I am bounding here this quantity is trivially less than 2, this ratio. Simply because if I take my ball disjoint from the set E, there I count twice the volume of E, divided by the volume of E. So this quantity here is trivially bounded by 2. So here I'm, if this ratio, P over P of B, is not small, essentially I'm not saying anything, you know, because it's all in the constant. So somehow, the size of this constant tells me the size of the deficit starting from which my theorem becomes non-trivial. Okay, so essentially all I'm not able to really quantitatively say for which set, if you give me a set and we put there together and we compute the perimeter and we compute its deficit, I cannot tell you if my estimate applies in a non-trivial way. Okay, so at this level is just the information that we decay like that, in a sense. I will just have one proof in this talk, and it's not going to be this one, but I want to tell you something about this proof. So as you happen to know, probably you have seen at least one attempt of proof in your life of the isoperimetric inequality. Very likely it's based on some symmetrization idea. So you start from a generic set, and then you create a procedure to make a more symmetric set. The classical example is you take any set, and then you fix a line, and then you start chopping your set with slices that will have their geometry, maybe something strange, and then you just replace with a disk of the same volume. And then you do this slice by slice, and then your generic set becomes a sort of kebab thing, which is actually symmetric, which is good because this guy, it's a one-dimensional object. It just depends on the profile, right? But if you want to prove the isoperimetric inequality, that's good, because you don't change the volume, but you decrease the perimeter. So if you can prove it for the kebab, you have it for every set that it's symmetrized into the kebab. Okay? So symmetrizations are really natural in this setting to simplify the problem. And somehow, the idea behind this proof is to get a quantitative grasp on these techniques in order to get this estimate. So this is not trivial, but that's just what I wanted to say because it motivates my next slide. Because after we did that, which was somehow closing a problem that had been open for a while, this theorem was known in the plane in 1905, and we did that in 2008. So it had been closed for a long while. But when we did it, so we wanted to do something similar, but for which we couldn't apply our techniques. And that's my next isoperimetric theorem, which is the Wolf inequality. So here the setting is very similar. If this phi was a misprint for p, this was more or less my previous thing, right? But what I really mean here is that I am prescribing, you see, some function phi over the sphere. So, the mathematical property it will have is that if I extend it from the sphere to Rn in a one homogeneous way, it's convex. This is just a mathematical property that for one reason or the other, it must be there. And the energy that we are minimizing now is the integral over the boundary of E, so not just of the n minus one dimensional measure of E. But you see, direction by direction, I weight the perimeter with the phi, with the function phi. So this means, for example, that if I take a ball and I integrate and I compute that integral, so I am integrating over the boundary of the ball, phi of the normal. So phi of the normal will not be constant. For example, for the ball, this direction may be weighted differently than this direction, okay? And maybe there is some other shape for which the weight of this phi is constant in every direction. So who knows, all right? Well, I mean, that's not exactly how it works, but the idea is that this energy is anisotropic. So it will. So the question is, what happens if I take something like that and I minimize it at fixed volume? So the right-hand side here has the following meaning. I still have to say what it is. So the meaning will be the following. Take your phi, which is an anisotropic surface tension density. And you intersect all these hyperplanes to construct a convex set K. All right? So this convex set K is called the Wolf shape associated with the anisotropy phi. Okay? And essentially what appears here is the phi energy of this guy, K phi, given that the volume of my K is the same as the volume of E. So it's really the isoperimetric theorem, but instead of the perimeter, you have the anisotropic perimeter. Instead of the ball, you have this guy. Okay? And this guy is just obtained by taking a direction. So for each direction, okay, I look at the value of my phi in the direction nu. Say this will be the value. Then I compute the value here, then I compute the value here, and then I intersect all these half planes, and I get a set K. And there are, if, for example, if phi is constant, it's 1 over the sphere, then I get the ball. So k will be the unit ball. But in general, for example, if phi is the minimum of finitely many affine functions, you find what is called the crystalline case. You really find a convex polyhedron. All right? And so, and essentially, the motivation for this problem is in crystallography, indeed. So this guy, Wolf, was a crystallographer, a German crystallographer, who essentially understood the relation between the measurements you can do of these anisotropic surface tension and the shape of the crystals. So he understood this formula, I guess. So that there is a relation between the surface tension density and the shape you observe macroscopically. All right? And the Wolf theorem is exactly this. If you want to minimize an anisotropic surface tension at fixed volume, you end up with a ball, which is not really the ball, but it's the ball for this phi. All right? So, and this is, of course, interesting from my point of view, because given that my theorem, so I want to do exactly what I did before, right? I want to show that if you're almost optimal in this thing, then you are close to a Wolf shape. But it will be interesting trying doing that, because I cannot use symmetrization. Because in general, essentially every open bounded convex set will be the Wolf shape of some phi. So there is no symmetry I can play with. Okay? So here is just the statement that if equality holds, then your set E is going to be one of these Wolf shapes. So this is kind of a fully anisotropic variant of the isoperimetric problem, which comes from a physical problem, and which has its own mathematical interest. And so the theorem I got a couple of years later with Figalli and Pratelli is exactly the same theorem we proved in the isotropic case. Actually, this theorem contains the isotropic case as a particular case. You just take the phi to be constant, and then you get the whole theorem. All right? But there are two features that are interesting. So here you see the isoperimetric deficit has now changed in the obvious way, and also the quantity I control is no more the distance from the ball overlapping the most, but is the distance from the translation of the Wolf shape that overlaps the most. All right? These are obvious changes in my estimate. And there are two funny things. So the first one is that the exponent 2 is again sharp, which, I mean, maybe was not so obvious because somehow the problem has very much less regularity. I mean, here you have these crystalline shapes. And another funny thing is that the constant Cn that you get by this new proof is explicit, is polynomial in the dimension, and does not depend on phi. So this is a funny thing because you can imagine that your Wolf shape, I don't know, is a very thin and long ellipse. So it has some problem with the eccentricity that goes to zero or goes to infinity. And this may affect this stability theorem, which actually is completely robust with respect to that. So this is something that before you do it, it's not obvious, I think. And okay. And I think even more interesting than the theorem itself from the mathematical point of view is how we proved it. So without being trying to be not technical, but I want to advertise this technique. Okay, which is called optimal mass transportation. So so it will be based, what we do is going to be based on an extremely complicated and implicit smart way of parametrizing the set E with small phi deficit into the optimal shape. So there is a theorem called the Bernier-McCann theorem that out of the blue tells you that given these two sets, there is a very smart way of mapping one into the other. So why it's so smart? Because the map that we are going to use is going to be a gradient, and it's even more, it's going to be the gradient of a convex function. So in one dimension, right, the derivative of a convex function is monotone. So the gradient of a convex function in Rn has also some monotonicity property. If you imagine it as a map from Rn to Rn, it's like you have these, you can imagine, you should try to imagine it in a dynamical way. So here I have my set, and over there is the Wolf shape, and then my gradient of psi is bringing the set into the Wolf shape, but it's convex. So it means that if I have a bit of mass here and a little mass there in the direction of the Wolf shape, first I have to move these guys, and then I have to move the guys that were sitting behind. So there is some degree of monotonicity in doing this operation. So it's like pushing stuff, but in a very monotone and ordered way. So this is reflected, as I said. So the map is going to bring my competitor E into K, and even better, it's going to do that so that if you take the Jacobian, so the determinant of the gradient of the map, so the determinant of the Hessian, this is going to be constant. It's just the ratio of the two volumes. So if they have the same volume, the determinant of the the change of variable is 1. So this means that, so this is my picture, each little volume element is completely preserved, and there is also a sort of ordering, you see? So the little squares are all moving in a row, in a sense, okay? They're kind of pushing gently one after the other. So there is kind of an ordering property. It's a mess even computing these maps. So it's really, I'm kind of selling it easy. But it's not easy computing them. But mathematically speaking, they have these properties that are extremely useful. And so just a word where it comes from, how do you construct such a map? You construct it by solving a problem that was that is called the Monge problem. So the Monge problem would be you want to bring E into K with a map. So T will be a map that bring my set E into the set K, all right? But I want to associate a cost for doing the transference of K into E. So from each point to E, I compute the distance from to T of X, which is the image. And I integrate these squared. So this is my cost from bringing a unit mass from E to a unit mass at X to a unit mass at T of X inside of K, all right? And then you try to find the map that does this so that the little volumes are preserved if they have same equal volume. So this is a completely nonlinear and dramatic constraint. So it's really crazy. And you try to do this in such a way to minimize this cost. Okay? So Gaspard Monge was thinking about taking a pile of sand and filling a hole in some construction problem. So he wanted to know what is the best way of doing that. And so he wrote down this problem, which is, mathematically speaking, is a nightmare because you're minimizing something that is maybe decent, but there is this highly nonlinear constraint. And so Kantorovich, who was an economist, actually got the Nobel in economy for that, because he realized a simple way to transform this thing into the minimization of a linear functional over a convex set. Extremely nice. So if you essentially you take this problem that is desperate and you listen to Kantorovich and you transform it into a linear problem over some more abstract object, you solve it, and then you come back to the problem and you write down the Euler-Lagrange equation for the problem, as every guy in the calculus of variation does, and then you discover that the Euler-Lagrange equation is telling you that the weak formulation of Kantorovich, you can forget about it. So you're actually solving the original problem. And even better, the Euler-Lagrange equation is telling you that the optimal map you find is the gradient of a convex function, which is this monotonicity property, which is quite obvious, right? If I have my pile of sand here, and I have the hole there, and I divide the pile of sand into the left part and the right part, it's true. I mean, I first have to move the right part to the right and then the left part to the right. It's very hard to believe that it's going to be convenient to move the right part on the left and then, you know, to make it jump. Why so? Because of the quadratic thing over there. Okay? So this is more or less what's going on here. So give me this map, okay? So all I ask you is to believe that I have this map. It's going to bring E into K and have constant determinant. And this is going to be the only proof in my talk. So it's three lines. But I decided I at least wanted a proof in the talk. And if it has one proof, it has to be a proof by Gromov, okay, of course. So, which, of course, is it's a name that is known also in physics, I guess. So what is Gromov's argument to prove this Wolff inequality, and in particular the isoperimetric inequality, using a map like that? So Gromov will take the left-hand side of the inequality, which is just the perimeter of a Wolff shape, all right? But now he understands that as a volume term. And he says, okay, I have this mixture of powers of the two volumes, and I realize that since the determinant of my guy is constant, it's k over e, if I integrate over e, this quantity here, I just get the left-hand side. All right, so this is just an identity. This is nothing simpler than that. Right? I just substitute the constant value of the determinant. Then you notice that, this is the Hessian of a convex function, right? So this is going to be the product. So the determinant of this thing to the 1 over n, this is the product of a bunch of non-negative numbers, right? Which are the principal values of the Hessian. So by the arithmetic geometric mean inequality, this is just the sum of the guys divided by n, which is the Laplacian of psi divided by n. So here is where you use the convexity. So in the fact that this determinant is not just is positive because it's the product of positive numbers. And positive numbers, you can apply the arithmetic so the geometric mean is less than the arithmetic mean, with equality if and only if all of them are equal. Okay, so this is less than the Laplacian. The Laplacian, you integrate it by parts, and then you do a little inequality, which is a tautology. So I have the gradient scalar, the normal, and I have phi of the normal. Why? Because I want the anisotropic perimeter, right? So what else should I put there? But what is phi star? Phi star is, by definition, the smallest number I put there so that the inequality is true. So phi star will be defined like the infimum of this over that, so that the inequality is true. Which doesn't seem particularly clever, but you go back to the definition of the Wolf shape, and you realize that the Wolf shape is exactly the set where the phi star you need here is less than 1. That's too good to be true. So somehow this inequality, you ask it out of desperation, because otherwise you don't know how to make phi of nu to appear in the game, and it creates some phi star computer that is gradient of psi at the transport map, and in principle you could do nothing about that, but the gradient of psi is bringing points of E into K, and K happens to be exactly the set where phi star is less than 1. So this guy here is less than 1, therefore here I just have the integral of phi of nu, which is an isotropy. And that's the end of the proof. This proves the isoperimetric inequality in 2 lines, given that you have the map. Now, what am I going to do with that? So that's not the end of the story for me. Now I want to understand this quantitatively, right? So it means that I have this minus that, phi of E minus this guy, this is going to be my deficit. So, and each time I see an inequality sign, I am getting an information along this proof. So the first information that comes to your mind to use is this arithmetic geometric mean inequality, which is essentially the isoperimetric problem on boxes. So if you try to solve the isoperimetric problem on boxes, rectangular boxes, that's the statement. The optimal thing to do is a nice cube. Not a nice cube, a nice cube. Okay? And so essentially it's what's happening here, right? So essentially I'm telling you, well, if this is 0, it's because all the eigenvalues are the same. So this is because the Hessian of psi is close to the identity. And how will that happen with some square? Because this is going to be a minimum inequality of a very nice function, right? So it's going to be quadratic. So what I'm trying to say with this thing is that if you play 50 minutes with this thing, after a while you realize that, okay, I control the full Hessian of my map minus the identity in some integrated sense, right? So if the deficit is 0, of course, the Hessian is the identity. So the map psi, the gradient of psi is a translation, and then E was the Wolf shape translated somewhere. So that's how simple that is. Okay, but what to do with that? So we say we want to prove that the deficit controls the L1 distance from the Wolf shape squared, right? But all we know is that it controls this Hessian of the transport map minus identity. So if this is 0, the gradient of psi, which brings E into K, is a translation. But I control the derivative. So I apply the Poincaré inequality, which means that I control the derivative of a function, so I control the distance of my function from a constant in an integral sense, right? So that's exactly what happens here. So with the Poincaré constant of my set E, I control the distance of the gradient of psi from the identity, from a translation, so from the identity up to translation, and then this will be the square of this, it's clearly proportional to that. That's a triviality. But the key step, the only thing I want to say, is the key step is that you have to apply some form of Poincaré inequality, okay? So the Poincaré inequality, the quantitative version of gradient zero implies you're almost constant. But the Poincaré inequality is a very delicate inequality, right? It doesn't hold on disconnected sets. So if you have a disconnected set, two components, it's not true that the size of the gradient controls how far you are from a constant, for the trivial reasons that you could be two different constants, right? And as I already shown you, an almost isoperimetric set can have disconnected components. It can even have these spikes that completely destroy Poincaré inequalities, as much as tubes. So in general, for one of the sets we are talking about, the Poincaré constant is zero flat. So you can't do this proof. So the way we did the proof was to trim down all the problems. So we found a lemma that somehow tells you that you can chop down everything that creates trouble, and the beauty of the problem tells you that this is allowed. You're changing the set in a negligible way, in such a way that if you can prove the inequality on this nice guy, then it holds for the bad guy. And that's it. That's the proof, more or less. So the proof really is understanding what is bad for the Poincaré constant. You find a way to describe them that is compatible with the problem, and then the problem allows you to get rid of them. Yeah. So essentially, the criterion to chop down things, the criterion is the following. So the scale has been set to 1 because, say, that the volume of V is the volume of K at this level. So there is a problem of really scaling that has been cleared by this. And then essentially, what is so why the spike is bad? The spike is bad because, so if you have a spike, what is really a problem is that, you see, that I can make a subset out of the spike, and the ratio between this area and this area is going to be very small, which means that with very small gradient, I can make a transition from 0 to 1. That's what kills the Poincaré inequality, or almost kill it. You know, and then, but then, the arguments say, so the bad guys are like, small. This is very small with respect to that, and so if I chop it, indeed, I'm not changing the perimeter that much, actually I'm making that better. So this is the kind of idea that is behind this theorem. Okay, so now let's talk about something different but related. This is the plateau problem. So in the plateau problem, you are given a curve and you want to fill it so to minimize the area. So in my notation here, you see I have an n-dimensional surface M, and I look at competitors M tilde with the same boundary, and M is going to be a solution to the plateau problem if it has less area. All right? And so, what would be my stability theorem? So if this is M, say it's a straight segment in R2, and this is a competitor M tilde, I want to control the volume of the region the two together bound in terms of the mismatch of the area. So if M tilde is not optimal too, right, the difference in area should control the volume of the region spent by the two surfaces. So for example, say that my surface M is a disk, which is clearly area minimizing, and then I start constructing something on the top of it with the same boundary, and I want to control the volume of the region enclosed by the two. So I want to make my quantitative theorems over the plateau problem. There is a lot of non-uniqueness in the plateau problem at times. Well, it's not a lot. It's actually uniqueness of solutions is generic, in a sense. So but at times there is non-uniqueness, so you have to be a bit careful here, okay? Because if you don't assume uniqueness, you may end up in a situation where you have two competitors for which this is an equality, but they span a region of a positive area. So in this case, if you take these two guys, they have the same boundary, minus plus, but they will have, here they will bound the square if you take the object that fills them. So, and the theorem I prove with Guido De Filippis, who is now in CISSA, is the following. So take any smooth and uniquely area-minimizing surface, okay? So there is here, for the mathematicians in the room, a line among currents, because actually you may dream that you can do these things without worrying about singularities, but actually if you try to solve the plateau problem and you just want smooth surfaces, it may happen that life brings you to surfaces with singularities, okay? So in a sense, you have to formulate this minimality property a bit outside of classical differential geometry. Otherwise, it could make no sense. But let's say that M is smooth and uniquely area minimizing. Then our theorem tells you that if you take any surface M tilde with the same boundary as M, and you consider the region E that is between the two guys, then the difference in areas controls the volume of the region with the square. So it's exactly the same estimate that I get for the isoperimetric problem, right? But you see, now there is also another factor, which is also sharp. It's called the isoperimetric regime, because you see, the problem we are trying to discuss now, right? So essentially, we are saying here there is a surface M, here there is a surface M tilde, they have the same boundary, and if this is area minimizing, the difference in area should control the volume of E. But what happens if this is M, this is M tilde, is a super large object, right? Then the deficit that you're considering, Hn of M tilde minus Hn of M, well, is actually essentially the same as the same thing with the plus, right? Which is the total perimeter of the bounded set E. So the only quantity I can control in this situation is the volume of E to this normalized power. That is the isoperimetric inequality. So this is more or less why I need the two things there. So this would be the theorem. There exists a positive constant such that, and this is false, in principle, because it's actually this theorem is an if and only if with the fact that if you take the first eigenvalue of the second variation of the area over your surface, you want this thing to be positive. So you may think to this thing as the first eigenvalue of minus Laplacian of phi equal to the square norm of the second fundamental form of the surface times phi. It's a geometric equation, okay? So these are called the solutions to this thing are important because somehow, if you have a non-trivial solution, okay? So these are important because, equal to lambda mu phi, it's an eigenvalue problem. So these are important because if this number is positive, it tells you that your area minimizing surface, this number would be non-negative in general, right? Because this is an area minimizing object. So the second variation of the area must be non-negative. So what I'm saying is that if it is strictly stable, if this number is strictly positive, then I have a constant to put there. But there are examples of area minimizing surfaces for which this number can be sadly zero. Which means that there are infinitesimal ways, so there are flows of this surface that up to second order don't change the area. And then my estimate, who knows? So my conjecture with Guido is that when the first eigenvalue is zero, nevertheless, the exponent you get in the inequality, these two, should always be replaced by an integer. So somehow, our idea is that the area functional should be, in a sense, analytic. Okay, you shouldn't be able to find something such that you detach with an infinite order from zero. So you have to detach with some power. Okay, and we have even a vague idea of how to do that, but we don't know. Otherwise, we would have done that. Right? So that's a conjecture. And so what about singularities? So let me check the time, because I don't want to... Okay, maybe I want to skip singularities. So because there are a lot of area-minimizing surfaces that are singular, so they're really cones. They have point singularities. So these are quite delicate objects. Well, let me tell you about them. So you see, you start seeing them in quite high dimensions. So for example, these are called the Lawson cones. It's the most famous family of singular area-minimizing surfaces. So these are, in some RK times RH, they satisfy this simple equation. So you say your position is xy, and mod x is equal to mod y with some constant, depending on the dimension. So it's some kind of cone over a sphere, over a cross product of spheres. And if you do that with the right radii, this happens to be zero mean curvature. That's very easy to check, okay? To check that they have first variation zero. And then you ask yourself, when is it true that these guys are uniquely area minimizing? And then there is a theorem that many, many people have contributed to prove, but that tells you that if the total dimension is at least 9, or in dimension 8, in the cases 4, 4, and 3, 5, but not 2, 6, for example, these objects are uniquely area minimizing, which is a bit crazy because if you think about them, these are cones, right? So these are cones. So I'm saying something like mod x equal to alpha mod y. And then my picture is immediately that. And then you tell me, but this is trivially not area minimizing because if you fix the boundary data of this thing, right, and then you chop here the thing with two hyperplanes, you're going to decrease the area without changing the boundary condition. That's obvious. And indeed, this is not the right picture because you're at least in dimension 8, and that strange equation is, in fact, is telling you that this thing wraps around the origin. So there is a singularity at the origin, but the surface arrives to the singularity from so many positions that you cannot even try to think about moving an hyperplane and cut off the singularity. Of course, you cannot see, I cannot see it, but this must be true, right? Otherwise, I could say that they're not good. So, okay, you have these guys, and with Guido, in the same paper, we prove the stability inequality. So maybe don't lose your sight over my inequality here. It's a bit complicated. But it's the usual stability inequality, okay? So I control any competitors, I control the square of the volume of the bounding set. Unfortunately, we can prove, well, not unfortunately, maybe who cares, but we just cannot prove it in the case where k is equal to 2 and h goes from 7 to 11, or in the case 3 and 5. Simply, our proof goes blank. So I don't know if this is because our proof is not the right proof for this problem, or because there is something wrong in these six or seven cases. This is beyond my... But there is a nice consequence of this theorem. So this theorem comes from a kind of a global argument, some sort of calibration argument. So it's really, in the end, it's a computation. It's really a calculus two computation. You could have, it's a calculus two computation. But as a consequence of this thing, you get something quite non-trivial, which is an estimate for the first eigenvalue of the second fundamental form. Right? Remember that in the previous slide, I told you that if you have this inequality, this number km is related to the first eigenvalue of the second fundamental form. And it's a two-way thing. So if k is positive, lambda is positive, and vice versa. And actually, if k is positive, then lambda is at least that much of k. So they are really related in the other way. So my theorem with Guido gives you an explicit constant, which is this monster here, this C here. But if you write down this constant this constant implies a bound on the first eigenvalue, which is something hard to obtain because you should be able to, I don't know how to obtain. In general, giving explicit bounds of eigenvalues is not trivial, okay? And this comes somehow as a free lunch out of a smart computation. So we were very happy. Also because if you take k equal h, so if you do this on a symmetric product, R4 times R4 and higher, okay? You see, this k over h becomes 1, so it doesn't bother you anymore. And you just have a number times h to the 1/4, which goes to plus infinity. So this is telling you something interesting. It tells you that the symmetric cones are becoming increasingly stable as the dimension goes, which is consistent with the fact that these cones are not minimizing, say, in R4, are not minimizing in R6. They start becoming minimizing in R8, and then the more the dimension grows, the more they become stable, okay? So that's the first quantitative thing about this minimality property that I've seen in my life, maybe because I'm ignorant and I don't read enough. Okay, now the big conjecture. So this is really big. So if you can solve this, mathematicians will be crazy because this is a big problem. So it's called the Michael-Simon conjecture. And it starts with a theorem, actually, as every conjecture. It starts with a positive result. So you have an n-dimensional surface in Rn plus 1, typically in my talk it was Rn plus 1 so far, an n-dimensional object with codimension 1. But for what this theorem cares is an n-dimensional surface in arbitrary codimension. Rn plus k, it's totally fine. Okay? So, and this surface will have zero mean curvature, which means that first variation of the area is zero. Doesn't mean it's area minimizing. It just means if I start modifying my surface in a nice way, the first derivative along the flow of the area is zero. That's it. Doesn't imply area minimality. It's just some sort of criticality. Okay. When you take an object like that, then the conclusion is that the measure of the boundary is at least a constant, the volume of your surface to this power. So its perimeter controls volume for minimal surfaces. So you have to imagine something like, I don't know, let's take a minimal surface that it's familiar, a catenoid. So a catenoid in R3, this would be telling me that, and now I chop it so that it's finite measure. So I take a piece of a catenoid, then the inequality is telling me that the hn minus 1 of the boundary would be this thing here, is at least that power of the volume up to a constant, which surprisingly is independent of the codimension. Which I think it's extremely, extremely cool, because zero mean curvature is an extrinsic condition, right? So the curvature measures, mean curvature measures the bending of the thing in the space. But this effect of life is independent of the codimension. So it's not like if I have higher codimension, I have more ways of bending this thing, and then I get, say, a worse constant. So that's already a very interesting theorem. But then it becomes even more interesting if you notice that you already knew an example of this theorem, a particular case, an important particular case, which is, say that your set M, your surface M, was contained into some n-dimensional plane. So this completely kills the codimension, right? Because now it's just an n-dimensional object sitting in some Rn. So the thing here is just the Euclidean isoperimetric inequality. So the perimeter of your set M is at least the isoperimetric constant, So omega n will be the volume of the unit ball, and this will be the isoperimetric constant, then n omega n to the 1 over n. And then this is the volume of your set to this power. So this is the usual boring isoperimetric inequality, all right? And this is a particular case, because if m is contained in an hyperplane, it's definitely something with zero mean curvature, right? So in particular, subsets of Rn embedded into Rn plus k are examples. So this constant Cn must be... I got the wrong sign. The constant Cn of the Michael Simon theorem is less than that. I got the